evening. I'd like to welcome you here on this cool evening. I'd like to introduce to you Wendy Rose.
Leonard Sook from Fort Hays State University.
Good evening. Can everybody hear me okay? Yeah? Okay. I'm attached to a number of different things for recording purposes, so are we okay with that? So far, so good? Okay. All right. Well, welcome, everyone. As she said, my name is Wendy Roletter Sook. I'm the Director of Financial Aid at Fort Hays State University. But I'm here tonight on behalf of CASFA, which is the Kansas Association of Student Financial Aid Administrators. And CASFA is a group that hosts these types of events throughout the state to give parents and students an opportunity to learn about financial aid, kind of the basics of financial aid that should be applicable wherever you apply to go to school. So this is not specific to Fort Hays. It is more general in nature. Some of the examples I may give, I may tell you what happens at Fort Hays, but for some things, you will want to contact the financial aid office at whatever schools your students is interested in attending to get information or to know about deadlines and that sort of thing. I have a number of slides to go through to give you a good overview. I'm happy also to take questions. So if you have a question that's pretty general in nature that you want to ask in front of the group, I'm happy to take those, but I'm also happy to stay afterwards and answer any individual questions that you have. Okay, so let's get started. So what you need to know about financial aid. Things that we're going to cover tonight. First, we're going to talk about what financial aid is, what a cost of attendance or a budget is, how an expected family contribution is determined, or what we call an EFC, what financial need is, what are the types, the sources, the categories of financial aid, the FAFSA, the Free Application for Federal Student Aid. And then we're going to talk a little bit about possible special circumstances and how we can address those in the financial aid awarding process. So when we talk about financial aid, we use that term very broadly to encompass a number of different things. So that encompasses all funds that are provided to students and families to help pay for post-secondary educational expenses. So that could include scholarships, that could include grants, loans, work study, all the different types of money that a student can use to help pay for post-secondary expenses. Sometimes when we hear people say financial aid, they're just talking about grants or they're just talking about the Pell Grant. That's not really the case. Financial aid is a very broad term, so it's all the funds, no matter what type, whether they are free money or have to be paid back. So what is the cost of attendance? Sometimes you'll also hear this referred to as a budget. But the cost of attendance basically is what a student can be expected to pay to cover all educational expenses for that 1 year. So a cost of attendance would include tuition and fees, room and board, books and supplies. I think those are the common ones that everybody assumes that will be there. But also there's some amounts allotted for transportation as well as personal expenses. So we look at everything. What's the total cost that's going to be expected for a student to attend post-secondary education? And then I also think it's important to point out what are direct costs and what are indirect costs. And by that I mean, what costs are you going to be assessed up front by the school that you're going to have to pay, that's going to be billed on their university billing? And then what are some of the indirect costs? So direct costs would be primarily your tuition and fees. For many institutions, it's also the room and board if they're living on campus in a residence hall, and also then books and supplies. They may add that to the university bill, or they may have to go and purchase that at a bookstore with maybe excess financial aid that they receive. But those are direct costs. You're going to have to pay those, probably going to have to pay those up front in order to get to school. And then your indirect costs would be some of those incidental costs that vary depending on the student. So that could be transportation expenses or personal expenses. The example that I like to give students about some of these, how they are indirect and variable costs, really depends on the student's situation. So if a student is going to a school that's in their hometown, they may not have as much to pay for in the way of transportation as a student who's going to school 3 hours from their home and maybe making regular trips back and forth to home and school. So the expenses will really vary depending on what the student's particular situation is. And then the cost of attendance varies widely from college to college, because as you can see from the examples that I gave there, those costs will vary. Tuition fees will vary depending on the school that a student goes to, as well as room and board. Books and supplies are probably fairly standard now that a lot of students purchase their books online. So that can be a pretty standard cost, but there are lots of variations in those. So taking a look at what all of those expenses are going to be is a really good first starting point to figure out what the costs are going to be for you. So what is an expected family contribution? This is the amount that a family can be reasonably expected to contribute to a student's educational costs. This will be the same no matter where a student goes to school. It's calculated through the FAFSA, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute, but it will be the same regardless of what school the student goes to. So the cost of the school is not going to impact your estimated family contribution. It's going to be the same at school A and school B. Two components for students who are dependent students, and this would be the parent contribution as well as the student contribution. So they are looking at income and tax information for both students and parents to contribute to that estimated expected family contribution. It's calculated using data from the federal application, from the FAFSA, and a federal formula. So they have a complicated formula. Once you put in all your FAFSA information that they use to create the expected family contribution, it does take into account if a family makes $50,000, your EFC is not going to be $50,000. There are a lot of income protection allowances that are calculated in that formula because they understand part of that $50,000 may need to go to a mortgage, may need to go to provide food for the family and that sort of thing. So it's a formula using that income information provided by the parent and the student. So what is financial need? So when we're calculating what sort of financial need a student has, we are taking the cost of attendance for that student at whatever school they're attending, subtract the expected family contribution, and that equals their financial need. So when you're looking at how it compares then at different schools, your cost of attendance is variable. Your expected family contribution is going to be constant. That's going to be the same, but then your need is going to be variable because of that variable cost of attendance. Okay, so in looking at types of aid, we break this into two categories, gift aid and self-help aid. Gift aid is the best kind of aid. It's free aid, an aid that doesn't have to be paid back. So that would be scholarships and grants for a couple of examples. And then there's self-help aid, which is aid that either has to be earned or paid back. So that would be loans or employment. So we'll talk about the specific types here in a minute. But first, looking at the different sources, the federal government provides probably the largest source of financial aid for students. But there are also states that provide some state aid. Colleges and universities may provide aid, usually in the way of scholarships or grants. There can be private sources, civic organizations, churches, and employers. That's just to name a few. So what's out there for students in the way of federal financial aid? Pell Grants, one of the most common sources of financial aid, is a grant that is based on the estimated or expected family contribution. So a student does have to have need in order to be eligible for a Pell Grant, and it's awarded automatically. If a student applies and they're eligible, they're automatically awarded a Pell Grant. Those amounts range for the current year anywhere from $290 to $5,775 for the year. So the lower a student's expected family contribution, the greater their Pell Grant's going to be. If they have a little bit higher expected family contribution, then their Pell Grant's going to be a lesser amount. The FSEOG is the Federal Supplemental Educational Opportunity Grant. That is a grant that is designed for the neediest of students, and it is based on availability. It is a limited funded program, so schools get just a certain amount allotted to them. They then award those to students, and most schools do that on a first-come, first-served basis. So I'm going to talk in a minute about filling out the FAFSA and the importance of priority deadlines, but please mental note that particular fund because that is one that is limited, which means it's awarded usually on a first-come, first-served basis. So the earlier you have your FAFSA submitted and you're eligible, the better chance you have of being awarded that type of aid. A TEACH grant is a grant program for those who are planning to teach in high-need fields in high-need geographic areas. It does require an agreement to serve. So a student, if they apply for a TEACH grant, agree to serve and teach in that high-need area in the geographic location for a certain number of years in order to continue to receive that grant. If they don't meet that obligation, that grant is then turned into an unsubsidized loan. So we always caution students to be sure that's really what they want to do before applying and obligating themselves to that TEACH grant because it will turn into a loan if they don't meet their service obligations. We are happy in our office to counsel students. I think most financial aid offices would be to help answer questions about the TEACH grant if students are thinking about possibly going into those high need areas. The Kansas Comprehensive Grant I've listed here because it is a fairly common state grant for students at our school and for a lot of other Kansas schools. It is determined by the Kansas legislature as far as how much funds every school gets. It's available at four-year colleges and universities in the state, and it is limited funds, so it is based on availability as well. Students also have to have need in order to be eligible for the Kansas Comprehensive Grant. Okay, federal work study are federal dollars that are paid to students in exchange for their part-time employment in designated jobs. We encourage students who are awarded work study to accept work study because it is helpful to employers because federal funds help pay some of the students' wages. It is not required in order to work on campus to have work study, but it certainly is helpful, like I said, to departments to help pay for some of those costs. So there may be some jobs that are work study only on campuses, but I think every campus also has other jobs available that a student does not have to have work study in order to get. The important thing to know about work study is that students have to apply and be hired in a job. They're not guaranteed that just by getting a work study award. So they still have to go through the job application process just like every other student who's looking for a part-time job and have to be hired in that job. It's also money that is not paid up front to the student. So they may receive a work study award, let's say of $3,000 for the year. They're not going to get all that money up front to help pay their tuition and fees or their room and board. That is $3,000 that they are eligible to earn in a part-time job. So they will be paid in a paycheck. Usually for most schools, it's every 2 weeks or maybe every month to get those wages. And then the last item there are federal direct loans. And those loans for undergraduates can be subsidized or unsubsidized loans. Subsidized loans are loans that are based on need. So a student does have to have financial need in order to receive them. And the federal government pays the interest on those loans while the student is enrolled at least half time. So it's a good loan because the interest is not going to accrue for that student until after they are no longer enrolled half time. Unsubsidized loan is the other type of loan. It is not need-based, so any student could be eligible for an unsubsidized loan. Interest will accrue on that loan as soon as it's disbursed to the student. So that will accrue while they are enrolled in school. They can defer that interest if they wish, so they don't have to pay that while it's accruing and they're enrolled. It can be deferred. Now, one thing to note with loans is that there are annual limits depending upon the student's grade classification. So for incoming freshmen, which I assume most of the students here tonight will be, their loan limit is $5,500 per year in direct loans. So that's the maximum amount they can take out. Of that $5,500, a maximum of $3,500 can be in subsidized loans. But again, a student does have to have financial need in order to be eligible for the subsidized loans. So if they have full subsidized loan eligibility, a freshman student would have $3,500 in subsidized loans and $2,000 in unsubsidized loans. Those annual amounts do change depending on their grade classification. So as sophomores, they would be eligible for $6,500 for the year. And then as juniors and seniors, $7,500 for the year. That is a variable interest rate that is determined on an annual basis based on the market. For 2015-16, that rate actually went down from the previous year slightly to 4.29%. And that is a fixed rate on that loan for that particular year. The other type of federal direct loan is a Parent PLUS loan. This is also the common loan that we see incoming students and their parents take out. It is a loan that is in the parent's name. Parents do usually have to submit, at least at our school, they have to submit a request and a master promissory note. And I think you'll find that the case at all institutions. So they fill out the request, the master promissory note, if they need some additional funds to help their student meet all the expenses that they have for that particular year. That rate varies by year. For 2015-16, it was 6.84%. And then the last option that we sometimes suggest to students, depending on what sort of situation they have, are private or alternative loans. We always encourage students to exhaust all their federal eligibility first, because usually federal loans have better terms than private or alternative loans do. But we also encourage students and their families to look around and see what kind of options they may have. And those, you know, interest rates and terms are going to vary on the applicant for those loans. Many times for a dependent student, they aren't able to obtain a private alternative loan in their name only. Usually they would have to have a co-signer in order to be able to do that. And sometimes parents choose to co-sign on a private loan for their students if they need some additional funds. Yeah.
Going back one slide.
Okay.
Where you referred to the unsubsidized. Who signs for those?
The student.
They're eligible if, yes, you know, they're a minor?
Yes.
Okay.
It's the student's name. And students are required, when they accept those loans, in order for that money to disperse to them, they have to go through entrance counseling and they have to sign a master promissory note. So that takes them through all of the terms of the loan, ask them questions so that they know that they understand what they're committing to, but those are loans in the student's name. Thank you for clarifying. Yes, the Parent PLUS loan is the only one that's in the parent's name. Yeah. So, you know, we always encourage students. I know many times parents want to help their students get through that process, or, you know, go and accept their aid for them and that sort of thing. We strongly advise against that because the student's the one who's committing and is on the hook for those loans, that they are the ones who need to make sure that they're accepting the loans. They're going through the entrance counseling and signing the master promissory note. They can do all of that electronically with their FSA ID that they use to fill out the FAFSA, but we strongly encourage that parents make sure their students are the ones who go through those processes. Okay. Okay, so how do you become eligible for federal aid? Well, the first step is to fill out the FAFSA, the Free Application for Federal Student Aid. And free is in red and bold and capitalized there, because that's the important piece to know about the FAFSA, is that it is a free application. There are some services out there that will charge families to fill out the FAFSA. We want to make sure that you don't go to one of those websites. If you go to the www.fafsa.gov, that will take you to the official free application for federal student aid. So don't ever pay someone to fill out the FAFSA. You can fill it out for free. But like I said, there are companies who charge, and then they take all the information you've given them and they go to the free application and fill it out. So make sure you go to the free one. FAFSA.gov is where you want to go. This is what the website looks like, and you'll be able to start a new FAFSA, your student. So I have a few screenshots here in a minute that will kind of show you what to expect and what your students will see. But just to kind of briefly talk about what the FAFSA is. It, as I said, the information that you provide there is what they use to calculate the expected family contribution. That's going to determine what sort of financial aid your student is eligible for. The 2016-17 FAFSA will be available January 1st of 2016. Now, it does require that you have some tax information and income information from 2015, And we understand that sometimes you don't have that on January 1st. But the thing to note there is that a lot of schools will set FAFSA priority deadlines. For example, Fort Hays has one of March 1st. So make sure that you're checking with the schools that you or your student is interested in and find out what their FAFSA priority deadlines are. We always suggest to students that if they don't have their tax information complete and the actual numbers ready to put into the FAFSA to meet the priority deadline, that they should submit it using estimates. A lot of times parents and students can use the previous tax year's information to get a good estimate to put in. They can use the estimate, submit their FAFSA, and then once they have filed their taxes, they can go back in and make a correction and update it with the actual amounts. So it's very important that students meet the FAFSA priority deadlines, because as I was talking about some of those limited funded programs, those are awarded on a first come, first served basis. So your student has the best shot at being awarded some of those funds if they have their FAFSA in early. So make sure that you know what the priority deadline is for the schools that your student is looking at. We encourage students to use the electronic version on the web to submit the FAFSA. There is a paper application available. Processing time, though, and the complexity of doing it, I think, is a disadvantage for students. I know that the vast majority, I'm sure it's over 95% of FAFSAs are submitted online, and we would strongly recommend that your students submit it online. If they don't, I think you can expect some delays in getting any turnaround time on processing that. So one of the first sections that your student will see is the student demographics section. So this will ask, you know, lots of basic standard information. Make sure that your student uses their legal name, because there will be a check with the Social Security Administration to make sure that the name and the Social Security number match. And if the names are different, it may not match, and that creates a problem. So make sure that they use their full legal name, and they're consistent about that on everything that they submit for college. So whether that's admission or applications for admission, or that scholarship applications, whatever, make sure that they're using their full legal name. Make sure the Social Security number is right. And I know this sometimes sounds obvious, but every year we have people who they'll, you know, slip digits, or they'll be one number off. And that then creates an issue, because if there's not going to be a match, the name doesn't match with that number in the Social Security database. So be real careful about making sure that that name and social both are accurate and match. They will ask for gender. The reason that they do that is for selective service registration. So it will do a selective service check. So anyone born as male who has not registered for the selective service, that will flag for them, and then we'll have to ask for documentation that they have registered for selective service. They will ask citizenship questions. For US citizens, they will have a Social Security number tied to their name, and as I said, they'll do that check. If they are an eligible non-citizen, they'll have both a Social Security number and an alien registration number that they will submit. Grade level is one that we do get quite a few mistakes on in our office. Because sometimes incoming freshmen think that they are graduate students. They are not. So they need to make sure that they are indicating they are undergraduate students, and they are not seniors yet. Now, they're seniors in high school, but they're not seniors in college. So they need to make sure that they're indicating they're incoming freshmen undergraduate students to make sure that that is correct. The degree they are seeking could be an associate's degree or could be a bachelor's degree, depending on what they're pursuing. But it is not yet a master's or a PhD. So making sure that they're indicating associate's or bachelor's degree, if that's the program that they're doing, not a master's or PhD off the bat for most students. And then there's a question about foster care. So if they were a foster youth or they were at any time in the foster care system, that's been a recent addition to the FAFSA, and that's in part for the department to give them information about other resources that may be available to them. So they will direct them sometimes to some state resources. There may be some state scholarships or state tuition waivers that they may have access to. So that's why they ask that question. Students can identify up to 10 colleges to receive their FAFSA results. So if students don't know yet where they want to go, I know that's the case for a lot of students, they're choosing between a number of different schools, they can include up to 10 colleges who will then receive their FAFSA information. So once they do that, you know, those 10 schools are going to bring in their information and then they're going to start contacting the student. So they may have to do a number of things at each school. So I think sometimes the earlier they narrow that down, the less work it is to make sure that they're getting all the information to all the different schools. But that certainly will keep their options open for them. So if they're really seriously considering 10 schools, I would say make sure that they're all on there so that all those schools get their FAFSA information. They do ask housing questions, and what helps, or what this the purpose of asking a housing question, we'll ask, are you living at home with your parents? Are you on campus or off campus? Is that helps us determine what their cost of attendance or their budget is. So a student who is living on campus is going to be allowed a larger amount for room and board than a student who's living at home. So that's the reason that we ask that question. Students can change their mind. So if they, at the point that they filled out the FAFSA, they were living at home and then they got closer to school and they said, no, I'm living on campus, they can make that change and we can make the adjustment to their budget. Okay, so one of the questions that we get a lot has to do with their dependency status. And for the most part, with this audience, I would assume that most of the students who will be submitting FAFSAs are probably dependent students. But it is possible that they may meet one of the criteria in order to be an independent student. So some of the criteria there, if they answer yes to any of the questions related to these items that you can see, and I'll read through them real quickly. If they answer yes to any of them, they could be an independent student, okay? If they were born before January 1st of 1993, they were a veteran, active duty military, married, have children or other dependents, both parents are deceased, they were in foster care past the age of 13, they were a dependent or ward of the court past the age of 13, they were under legal guardianship, they were an emancipated minor, they were homeless or at risk of being homeless, or a graduate student. So if they answer yes to any of those questions, they could be classified as an independent student, which means that when they're filling out the FAFSA, they are only putting on their information. And if they're married, they would put their spouse's information on there as well, but they would not include their parents' information. For most students, incoming freshmen, traditional age students, they don't meet any of those criteria. So they answer no to all those questions, and then they are a dependent student. We frequently get questions from students, or they tell us, you know, I file as an independent, I claim myself on my taxes, my parents don't claim me. That doesn't matter. For the purposes of the FAFSA, your filing status, your dependency status for the FAFSA is different than for tax purposes. So as long as they answer no to all these questions, they're considered a dependent student, and the Department of Ed has said we expect both you and your parents to make a reasonable contribution to your post-secondary educational expenses.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a little bit off, but your student or your child, if GPA, the student is files independently, mm-hmm. does that change? They have to be a dependent to get your insurance? Do you know about that?
No. You mean in order to qualify to be on your health insurance?
Yes.
They have to be, are you asking, do they have to be a dependent?
I have to claim them as a dependent to have them on my insurance.
Oh, you're asking me if that's the case? I don't know. I think that depends on your insurance requirements. So, sorry, I can't answer that. Okay, parent information on the FAFSA. One of the questions that they will ask on the FAFSA is, they have to identify basically parent one and, if applicable, parent two. So a lot of times we have questions from students, if both of their parents are married, they add one for parent one and one for parent two, and that's fine. As long as they're consistent through the rest of the financial aid application, you can put either one in parent one or two, but make sure that you keep the information the same as you go down. Occasionally we have students who have questions that perhaps their parents are not married. Well, if their parents are living together, regardless of whether they're married or not, they do have to include income information for both parents. This is actually a relatively recent change, and that's why we talk about it in this session, that previously, if the parents were not married, they only had to use one parent's income information. That's no longer the case. If they're living together, regardless of whether they're married or not, they have to include financial information from both parents. This does include same-sex partners as well. If the parents are divorced or separated, they need to include financial information for the parent that they lived with more during the last 12 months. If that parent is remarried to someone else, they also have to include that step-parent's information. The FAFSA, this brings me to the point about when you're submitting the FAFSA online, there are a lot of really good help boxes or more information boxes by a lot of these questions. So if there's a question that, you know, your answer, there's not a really clear answer for you, or you need a little bit more instructions or guidance, click on the additional boxes they have there, and it will expand with some additional explanation or instructions, and those can be really helpful. They have a really good infographic on the parent question. So if there's any confusion there about who or what information needs to be provided, please take a look at that infographic. I think it can be really helpful. Grandparents, foster parents, and legal guardians are not considered parents unless they legally adopted the student, in which case they would include them as the parent information. Otherwise, they do not. Okay, so what information do you need to have available to complete the FAFSA? You'll need taxes, income information, any benefit summaries that you have. You'll need asset information with the exception of 401ks or IRA balances. You don't need to include that. And you do not need the value of your primary residence. So your home, you do not need to include that value either. Now, if you have another residence that's not your primary residence, you do need to include that one. You also need untaxed income, such as maybe child support received, to include on the FAFSA as well. What is good to know about the FAFSA is that you can log in, fill some of it out, save it, and come back to it. So you don't have to do it all in one sitting. You can go back and make changes if you don't have quite all the information that you need to complete the whole thing. One really great feature of the FAFSA within the last 5 years has been the addition of the IRS data retrieval tool. And what this allows you to do is basically import in your IRS tax information directly into the FAFSA. So if you file your taxes, the IRS processes your taxes. You then go in to fill out the FAFSA, and when it gets to the income information, if you're eligible, it will ask you if you want to use the IRS data retrieval tool. And if you say yes, it's going to then link you over to the IRS website. It's going to let you take a look at all of your tax information. It's going to give you the option to transfer that back to the FAFSA. We would strongly recommend doing that if you're eligible to use the IRS data retrieval tool. It will transfer it back into the FAFSA, let you look at it, and accept that information in the FAFSA. This is really helpful because it eliminates a lot of mistakes sometimes that parents or students make in recording that information in the FAFSA directly, because it's imported directly from the IRS. It also helps reduce additional documents that we may need later for a process called verification. If you've used the data retrieval tool, we don't have to get additional documents to verify income in the verification process. Usually the IRS data retrieval tool is available at the first part of February, because by then they have gone through and started processing some taxes. They do need a little bit of time from the time you submit your taxes until the data retrieval tool is available, because that doesn't happen just instantly. The IRS has to process your tax return before that information is available. One thing though that can work for parents and families, or students and families, is if they are submitting their information using estimates because they don't yet have all the tax information completed, they use estimates so that they can meet a priority deadline. When they go back in to make corrections after they have filed their taxes, they could go and use the IRS data retrieval tool and pull that information into the FAFSA and resubmit it to us with that information. Now, there are a few exceptions to the data retrieval tool. You can't use it if you file an amended tax return, or if you don't have a Social Security number, or if you are married and you're filing taxes separately. Yes, question in the back.
Will that work then to pull in last year's taxes, or just not see it?
You mean for the current year?
Yeah, if you're applying for next school year and you want to use last year's tax return, can you pull it into that?
If you're applying for next year, for the 2016-17 academic year, you'll have to use 2015 tax information. So you'll have to have filed the 2015 taxes, and that's the only option it's going to let you pull in to the system. Do we have any parents or students who are juniors right now? No? Okay, because things are changing a little bit for that class, but we'll talk about that class when they're here. Yeah.
If they use a 2015 on there, who has their taxes done by January 1st?
No one. No, that's what I said. I said it's available January 1, but most people are not going to have tax information to submit it then. I suppose if you wanted to use estimates, you could use estimates and submit it January 1st and then go back and update it with the actual numbers once you have filed.
Then you can use the IRS.
Right, right. As long as one of these exclusions does not apply to you, you should be eligible to use the IRS data retrieval tool. It's a great tool, so I strongly recommend it. Makes things easier for students, especially later on in the way of reducing the documents they're going to need to provide. Okay, I just want to highlight a few FAFSA errors that we see. Some of these I touched on a little bit earlier, but I just want to make you aware. Social Security numbers, divorced and remarried, parental information, income by parents or step-parents, any untaxed income, U.S. taxes paid, the household size for the family, as well as the number in college. There are great boxes for additional information on those too if there's any question there, but it does a really good job of explaining that. Real estate and investment net worth and what assets to include. But again, you can have your students submit the FAFSA. If they do need to make corrections, they can go and do that. They log back into the FAFSA under the regular website, and they can get back in, make corrections, and then resubmit those corrections to the schools that are on their FAFSA. One new change that happened at the end of kind of the application cycle last year is that they replaced what had been used as a PIN number for students to log in and sign, and parents to log in and sign the FAFSA, and they replaced it with an FSA ID. So if you have established a PIN for an older child who has been a student and you've submitted the FAFSA with them and you haven't yet transitioned to the FSA ID, you will need to do that before you'll be able to submit a FAFSA for 16-17. So if you have a PIN already, you'll want to go in and replace that, link up an FSA ID. If you don't already have a PIN, you'll want to go in and create a new FSA ID. It will be a username and password that you and your students will use to log in and sign the FAFSA. To get there, you can do fsaid.ed.gov. You can do that now. If you wish to go in there and create your FSA ID, you and your student, you can go and do that right now. You're not going to be able to use it to submit a FAFSA yet, but you can go ahead and do that piece if you'd like. The FSA ID, they find, of course, is a more secure way to submit the information on the FAFSA. If you do have a PIN, it will link an option to that so you can connect it and basically keep all of your old information that was under that PIN and convert it to the new FSA ID. And lots of offers some self-service capability. So students and parents can go make changes to their account and that sort of thing. It's more like an account profile that you see for online shopping and those sorts of things. Yes?
So do you set up one PIN and ID for the child and the parents, or the parents need their own?
Yes, parents need their own. And one thing, thank you for asking that question, because the most important piece of information on that slide is there at the bottom that says each FSA ID requires a different email address. So don't make your student's FSA ID email address the same as what you want yours to be, because it will not let you do that. It will give you an error and will not let you create another FSA ID with that email address. So this is a great opportunity for you to make sure that your student is involved in taking ownership of their educational process with completing the FAFSA. responding to questions from financial aid offices and that sort of thing. They need to be the ones to go in, create their FSA ID, put in their email address that's a good email address. And one thing that I would make sure that your student is aware of is make sure that that's a good email address at a minimum to the start of the school year at that college for the student. Because occasionally we will have students who put in as their primary email address on the FAFSA, like a high school email address that then may become deactivated before they start college. Well, at Fort Hays, we use that email address as our primary means of communication. So we're sending them information or maybe asking for information. And if that email address is no longer valid, they're probably not getting it and able to respond. So make sure that that is a valid email address and will be good at least, like I said, until the start of school, that they start there so that they have received all the communication that they need to from that school and they've submitted all the information that they need to. So, great question. So make sure that you've got those are set up under two different email addresses. Because they will, when they go through and do the validation, they will send a code to that email address that they then will have to retrieve in order to activate the FSA ID. So what happens after your student files? They will send, will receive a summary of the application. So they will, first, they will send it to back to the student so that they can see what they have submitted. They can view it online at FAFSA.gov. They can view and see everything that they submitted on the FAFSA. They will also submit that information to the schools that they have listed that they want to receive the information. Schools will then contact students once they start bringing in their FAFSAs to let them know if they need any other documentation. It's always helpful to know how your school will contact students. At Fort Hays, we use the primary email address that they put on their FAFSA, their number one email address. That's how we will contact them. So make sure you're familiar with whatever schools your student is looking at, how they're going to communicate with them. We let students know then if we need any additional documents from them and where they can go to get those documents to provide to us. Also, I would strongly recommend that you are aware of whatever FERPA policy and requirements they have in a financial aid office has in order to share information with you. You will likely be required to sign a release. Sorry, your student will be required to sign a release of authorization to be for the financial aid office to be able to share information with you about their FAFSA. So it's helpful to know what the requirements are, what sort of authorization has to be done up front. So if you're interested in being able to talk with financial aid offices and get information, you should talk with your student about getting a release in order to have access to that information. A lot of schools will not start processing for the 16-17 award year until March and April. At that point, they will start bringing in FAFSA information and start contacting students if they need any additional documents, and then work on making awards to students with whatever financial aid that they are eligible for. Occasionally, there are circumstances that students or their families have that can't be accurately reflected in the FAFSA. Some examples of that could be maybe a change in employment status, maybe medical expenses that aren't covered by insurance, maybe there's a change in the parental marital status, different from what was submitted on the FAFSA. If those things happen or that situation arises, there's usually a process at the financial aid office that a student can provide a request for their financial aid office to review their file. They would need to provide an explanation and probably other documentation to the office that the financial aid office could review and determine if a change is necessary to better reflect what the student and the parent's current financial situation is. Decisions are up to the financial aid office and their administrators there. Once that decision is made, it's a final decision. So there's not an appeal process after that decision is made. Some of the specific, I gave you, I guess, time frame. The other one that we sometimes see a lot is there's a rollover maybe of a 401k. Maybe they've changed jobs and they've rolled it over and it's showing some as one-time income for them on the FAFSA. So it's inflating the expected family contribution in a way that's not really accurate because you don't really have access to that money. So we have on our form a selection that they can indicate this was a rollover, I don't have access to this money, and we can remove that as one-time income. We see that fairly commonly. One of the regulations that we are required to follow and document are that students are making what's called satisfactory academic progress towards their degree. So in order to receive financial aid and to continue receiving financial aid, students have to be making progress towards their degree. And we look at that in terms of time frame. So how many hours have they accumulated? How many hours are required for the degree? So are they far exceeding the number of hours that are required for the degree? If so, there's going to be a limit that they will no longer be eligible for financial aid. We also look at grade point averages, and this will vary based on schools. Whatever they have set as their grade point average, and sometimes it will vary, you know, after the first year it has to be X, after the second year it has to be Y, in order to continue to receive financial aid. And then the last one is what we call PACE, and that is of the total number of hours that the student has attempted, how many have they passed? So what is their PACE towards graduation? Our requirement is that they have to have completed at least 67% of the hours that they have attempted. So if students are in the habit of dropping a lot of classes or, you know, enrolling in more hours than they really intend to complete and then dropping those classes, that can have some negative impacts on them. That students need to be aware of those requirements for their satisfactory academic progress. And I would encourage students to take a look at what school that they're attending and what their satisfactory academic progress policy is. So I want to talk just real briefly here at the end about scholarships. I know that your counselors do a great job of making sure students are aware of scholarship opportunities that are out there, but I just want to put a few things out there to kind of reiterate probably the message that you're already getting from them. Scholarships, you know, we consider them as gift aid, similar to grants, free money that doesn't have to be paid back. Some, though, have restrictions on what they will pay, so it's always helpful to know up front if there are those types of restrictions. For example, do they pay direct costs only? You know, do they pay tuition and fees, books and supplies, room and board, nothing else? Are there enrollment restrictions? Does a student need to be full-time in order to receive the scholarship, or can they be something less than full-time? And they can come, of course, from multiple sources, and we listed a few of these earlier: institutions, organizations, employers. That list continues to grow, and I would encourage students, I know they hear this from their counselors too, but to take the time to apply for those scholarships, even if it looks like a relatively small amount. I've seen small amounts add up pretty quickly to make a pretty significant impact on a year's tuition or help with room and board. So I would strongly encourage students to really take the time to submit those applications, especially for those community or outside scholarships that they can use wherever they go to school. So it's helpful to know in talking about institutional scholarships, you know, does the school have a separate application for the scholarship? Are there multiple applications that they have to fill out for different scholarships? Are they considered with just one application? What's the deadline to apply? Some schools have early deadlines. Some of them probably have already passed in November, but there may be later final deadlines, so making sure students are aware of that. Is it based on merit? So is it based on academics, grades, ACT scores? Is it based on need? And if so, do they have to have financial need as determined by the FAFSA? Does it require any follow-up? Do I have to write a thank you note? Sometimes I've seen that as requirements. Is it renewable? So is it a scholarship that I can potentially get again my second, third, and fourth year? And if so, what are the requirements? Do I have to meet a certain GPA? Do I have to have completed a certain number of credit hours? Having all that information is really helpful to know what you're looking at. And I always challenge students, you know, don't just look at the first year. How am I going to pay for the first year and finish that? But how am I going to pay for 2, 3, and 4? What are the possible options that I'm going to have down the road? Am I going to have some scholarships that are just one time? I'm going to have to figure out how to make up for that money in the second year, in the third and fourth year. So being aware kind of year by year what the financial picture might look like. The Kansas Board of Regents has scholarship opportunities as well. And this is their website. If you go to kansasregents.org, you can get there. Here's the long website that it has. And they have opportunities for students to apply in a number of different scholarships. So I'd encourage your students to check it out. I don't have specific slides about all of them, but I have the whole list of them here. One of the most common ones is the Kansas State Scholarship. If you have students interested in taking a look at those, I would encourage you to go to the website, read through, see what scholarships they may be eligible for, and submit the application there. So where do you go from here? Make sure that you're taking a look at admission websites for the schools that you or your students are thinking about applying to, if you haven't done that already. Take a look at the financial aid websites, see if there's additional information there. Make sure that you're meeting the deadlines, so deadlines for admission as well as priority deadlines for the FAFSA. Submit requests for documents as soon as possible. The quicker that you can complete your financial aid file with a school, usually the earlier that they can get an award letter to you so you know what your financial aid package looks like there. And take the time to investigate other sources of aid that might be out there. Okay, I'm to the point that I'm happy to take some general questions if you want to ask questions with the group, but again, I'm happy to stay afterwards if you have some individual questions that you want to talk with me about. And do that. Anybody have some general questions? Yes?
On the part where you list, like, you know, if they're going to get an associate's degree, do they have options for both at school there too?
Yes, I believe so. There may be some certificate options there. There would be a list of different options. So, yeah, there would be some other ones besides those. Mm-hmm. Other questions? Yeah?
When you talked earlier about the unsubsidized loans, the freshman year there was a 55 cap and then it went up.
Mm-hmm.
Just as you talked about with the scholarships about the renewability, do you have to go through the entire process again? So you're done with your freshman year,
right.
You start the process, loan application, et cetera, for your second year.
Yeah. You have to fill out the FAFSA every year.
Okay.
You get to fill out the FAFSA every year. Now the thing is, they do a renewal application, so it is easier in the next year because they will keep some of that information already in there that you don't have to redo everything, but you'll need to update tax information. Now, the question I had asked earlier about whether there were any juniors here, the process for 17-18 is going to change, well, fairly dramatically, in that students are going to be able to use what they're calling the prior year tax information. So when someone had asked me about, can you use the year before, in 17-18 you will. So in 17-18, instead of using what would be the 2016 tax information, like the current process is, you'll be using the 2015 tax information again. And then for the previous year, it will go to the prior year. So it's going to look a little bit different. It's going to allow students to submit earlier because they're going to have the information available. But as far as filling out the FAFSA again, I don't think that the Department of Ed, they haven't promised that they're going to be able to just fill in that 2015 tax information again. So I wouldn't hold my breath that that's going to happen. But it would be information, you know, you've already have your taxes filed, and students will be able to submit earlier because they'll have all the information that they need. So.
And then with the FAFSA, based on what you said about that you want the student to take some form of ownership of the process, and then I'm going to have a login, she's going to have a login, will we be able to see that they in fact are getting the, you know, in other words, what view rights do we have? Do we have the whole package? In other words, if they're supposed to be doing certain things, and they say, I'm getting taken care of, if I dial in, am I going to see that in fact is happening?
So if you dial into the FAFSA, is that what you're saying? I mean, you're going to be able to see, yeah, because when you log in, you're going to have to get into their FAFSA for you to sign your part of the FAFSA.
Right.
Okay, so you'll be able to see that. I think the question actually will come into play after they have finished the FAFSA. It's gone to the schools that they're applying to, and the schools are now following up, needing additional information from the student. So that's going to be where you'll need to make sure that your student, you know, you have an open dialogue to make sure that they're doing the things that they need to. Most schools, though, are going to run that through like a student portal or something like that, that the student would have the login and access to. So, you know, however you choose to do that and monitor that with your student, you know your student best to know what to do with that. But usually that information is going to go by email to the student or through their university portal that they have at that school if they need additional documents. And depending on the school and what sort of software and that sort of thing that they have, some of that may be done by paper or by email. Some of them would have an electronic portal that they'll be able to log in and see what documents they need or even submit those documents electronically. Yes?
So just to clarify, I log in with my FSID. My daughter logged in with hers. We're looking at the same application.
And, yes, and I guess the piece is they're logging in with their financial aid. They're logging into their FAFSA. When they get to the point that they need parent information, then you're going to log in your piece of it, and you're going to sign your piece of it. It's going to be the same FAFSA, though. Does that make sense? Okay. Any other general questions?
You might talk a little more about FERPA, I think might help. Is that the right?
Mm-hmm.
Because I think that's a little confusing if you haven't had a student in college before, because even though you're paying the bill and it's mm-hmm. all your financial information, you can't just call and talk to people about financial aid.
Right.
So that might be helpful to clarify.
And that's the case with really all university records, that the student owns those records, that they're the ones that the university can provide information to. So they can't provide that information to other third parties without the student's release to do that. So the student has to sign a release saying, I give my mother or father their name, information or access to my financial information, maybe academic information, so they many times can pick and choose what information they will be willing to give their parent or any third party, frankly, access to. Well, I mean, you know, I think the goal is that you develop as best you can that open relationship with your student and have open communication about, okay, here, this is your educational experience, but we're an invested party in this too. You know, this is what we're providing and helping you with. This is, you know, your part of that or your ownership of that. So that's, you know, it's a federal law called the Federal Educational Rights and Privacy Act that restrict schools from providing that information to anyone other than the student without their release to do that. Oh, I don't. Not off the top of my head.
Years ago, because my oldest son, he had that.
Yeah.
15 years ago.
Yeah, at least. I'm thinking it was the 70s, but I could be wrong. I'd have to take a look. So, any other questions? Okay, again, I'm happy to stay afterwards if you have specific individual questions that you'd like to ask. Thank you for your time and for attending.